Hey everybody, welcome back to Slingin Dirt this week. We're going to have a $635,000 question to ask you.
Oh yeah, that's a touchy subject.
Oh, I'm telling you.
Hey, we're going to have a season recap this week on the halfway season point standing.
See where everybody's at. We're going to have a tech tip. We're going to talk toe plates.
And we're going to have a special segment with
Songer Says. And then, of course, we got the all too familiar fan of the week. So stay tuned. It's Slingin Dirt TV presented by Joe's Carty. Hey everybody, welcome back to Slingin Dirt TV. We got a quick show. Now, I'm gonna give you a heads up. This is gonna be probably a little bit of a shorter show. It is the halfway season, so we're gonna be doing some things different today, but I wanna open up the show, Jack. I seen this, a lot of people in racing seen this on Facebook.
I read it.
Yeah. Fulton, out of Fulton, New York, a guy has been awarded $635,000, meaning the racetrack owner and a driver, a current driver, it's two different individuals at the track. An older gentleman walked behind a car, doesn't matter what class, but he walked behind a car, he was looking at the lineups or whatever, and the guy that was in the car put it in reverse and backed over the guy, injuring him pretty badly. Well, the grand jury or whoever came back and said, well, you didn't have anything posted for a safe speed limit in reverse. And I'm like, okay, well then the other thing is the individual that got ran over, it's sad to see that they got ran over, but he was a former driver. It's not like this is somebody who's never been to the races.
Yeah, and we all know, I mean, even when you take your kids or your friends for the first time to track, the first thing you say to them is, these cars don't have horns.
Nope.
We can't see out of them except straight ahead for the most part. And the only way to get your attention is they're going to rev your engine, you know. And
oh, yeah.
You'll hear an engine rev.
I don't know about you, but I know I've had guys rev their engines just to let me know they're there, and I'll jump sky high.
Exactly, you know, and then you take it even further with cars like sprint cars who have to be push started, so they're going a little bit faster through the pits. You know, and the guy's a former driver, you know, you think he would know better. We don't ever want anybody to get hurt, but you know, stuff does happen, but you know, I don't understand why they're, you know, the track was found liable or the driver was found liable, because you know, that's just the state of today's society, I think.
Sue Happy, there's a paragraph right here in the article. I'm gonna read straight from the article. A jury decided this week, now this happened a while back, but a jury decided this week that the racetrack was negligent for not having a traffic pattern in an area with pedestrians. The dirt pit area had no lines or anything to mark where pedestrians should stand. The one thing I noticed is that you've never been to Boone Speedway. When you go to Boone Speedway and you've got 900 race cars over the course of a week, when you come through the pits, now there's a big part of the pit area where you can pretty much walk anywhere where you want, but to go from the back pit area to the main pit area, where you sign in to get your pit passes and wristbands and all that good stuff, they do have chalked off areas on the very ends of the fence. But to me, a smart person wouldn't walk in the middle of the roadway where the cars are anyways, but they still have them chalked off. So I understand what they're saying right here in the article. The dumbest thing I've ever heard of is it exceeded the speed limit for a car going in reverse. What in the hell is that?
You know,
and I don't understand that. I've never gone to Eagle Raceway, and I've never seen Roger Hayden put a sign or Joe Kaczynski at Eagle Speedway, all cars must go in 5 miles an hour in reverse.
Like we have speedometers and know what 5 miles an hour is. I have a hard enough time going 5 miles an hour and forward. So, you know, I think it's crazy that, you know, because all this does is open the door for more crap, more people. It's going to hurt the sport. It's going to hurt the promoters. It's going to hurt the tracks. It's going to be where drivers can't even take anybody but their pit crew in there, because then they have to stay in their little pit box. They're not allowed to wander out.
Well, and like I said, you take the fact that the guy that got ran over was a former driver, so it's not like he didn't know what was going on. You know, the last thing I do, or the first thing I do, I should say, is when whether at Eagle or I-80 or Clark County or Harlan or wherever I'm at, I don't know if you do this, is if I see a person sitting in that car, I'll actually, you know, and I'm going towards the pit shed or wherever I'm going, if I see somebody sitting in the car, I will slow down. Or are they getting ready to fire that thing up? Or are they getting ready to line up? Well, I'm like super
absolutely
alert.
And I know one of the things that both you and I do, being, you know, we always pit together and our crews work together, is every time we get in that car, our crew chief is standing right in front of us, telling us go, don't go, wait.
Yeah.
To make sure it's perfectly clear behind us before we back out. You know, and a lot of racers don't have that convenience of having a crew or having somebody back them out.
That's a good point.
You know, and all I can say is maybe you guys ought to back your cars in, which I've seen a lot of guys do that. They'll back their cars into where they're facing out, so when they get ready to leave the pits.
I understand, you know, back your cars in into your stall so you can pull out. But I've also seen a lot of cars that pull forward into the pit stall. But then here's the deal. You got a car right here. You got to back out. But you got four guys over here with the car. Four guys over here with the car. And they're just going to stand there like this. You know, I don't know how many times, whether I know the guy or not is irrelevant, but for my safety standpoint, I'll get in front of the car.
Sure.
And I'll be like,
yep.
You know, like this, and they love that.
Yeah, they need the help.
You know, it's just a simple, that little bit of help right there, even if you don't know the guy, can actually end up saving somebody, you know, an injury or worse off, death or something like that, because they're not backing over. You could save equipment because somebody's not coming down the pit. As this guy who's by himself backs out and this guy comes down, they T-bone each other.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, I can tell you from personal experience that stuff happens. One time at Eagle Raceway, I think it was probably our second year in a sport mod. My son was in the car. He was gonna back it out and take it out for hot laps. He throws it in gear, hits the gas, and the throttle sticks. He instantly turns, you know, the ignition off. He knew exactly what to do. But things like that can happen too. And you know, when you got, I mean, I don't know why this car was where this guy was standing looking at whatever he was looking at. I think he was looking at point standings or results or something like that. Why this guy was backing into him, I can't picture it in my head. But you know, you gotta have somebody help, and we gotta help each other too when it comes to getting in and out of the pits. I mean, your crew, if my crew chief is, you know, down the track because he was spotting for me and I get back before him because there's a problem or something, your guys jump in and they tell me where my pit spot is.
It's kind of funny. I've seen Fred and BJ, you know, BJ, your crew chief, I've seen them both look at each other like, who's going to go first?
Yeah.
It's kind of funny. I'm like, well, one of us has got to go. It's like, yep. Come on.
I usually just go by lineup. If you're ahead of me in the lineup, I let you
well,
go
I'm
first.
Talking when we leave the pit area.
Yeah, I know.
Because they're staring at each other like, are you going to go or are you going to go? I mean, I'm just like, well, one of us has got to go.
Yeah.
So.
No, I agree. But, you know, we got to be real careful with this kind of stuff. I think it's going to make people too happy and it's going to hurt the sport eventually.
Oh, it's going to,
it's just
yeah.
Like, you know, society is just getting crazy with this silly stuff. You know, you spill a hot cup of coffee in your lap from McDonald's.
Yeah, and you win $1 million.
And you sue them because it was too hot.
Yeah.
I don't get
maybe
it.
Maybe I'm going to sue Dr. Pepper because this Dr. Pepper's just way too cold. I don't know. I mean, it's waking me up. I mean, I want to sleep
in. All right, enough. We could go on and on about
yep.
This crap.
The one thing I do want to address, though, and I know you've dealt with this because we've already talked about it in the pits this year. A lot of drivers have. For the other teams out there, whether you have crew members, if you're a fan of the sport, you just wanted to pay the $20 or $30 and go into the pits, stay out of the driving lane. Oh my God.
And none of this crap walking around like this.
Yeah, if you want to be on your cell phone checking results or Facebook updates, that's great, that's fine. We want you involved, but stay out of the driving
lane.
Do it
in the pit stall. Don't
yeah,
do
I don't know how
around.
Many times at I-80 Speedway or Harlan, you'll be driving in the area designated for the car, and some idiot is going to be like this,
yeah.
And then you rev your engine, and here's what they do. They're sitting there, they're like this, they turn around like. At that point, I'm not going to lie, at times I want to use my front bumper for purposes it was not designed for. You get the hell out of my way.
And the other one that ticks me off, that's number one. Number two is, you know, cars are staging, you know, you're getting in your spot, and somebody just decides they want to be a deer and dart across in front of you.
Oh, man.
And they see you moving, they see you rolling instead of waiting till everybody comes to a stop or whatever. They decide they have to run between you and make you stop. It's like, really, people? Come on. Think about it.
I usually, if I know the cars are going this way, the first place I'm going is behind the cars. You know, if I know the car, you know, if the forward motion is this way, I'm not going to go this way. I'm going to go behind the car.
I mean, the first thing your mother teaches you is when you cross the street, look both ways. For Christ's sake, it goes for the same thing at the racetrack.
Yeah, you know, and it comes back to what you and I were talking here a couple weeks ago. You don't want to see anybody get hurt.
No.
And that's what irritates us most. One is the fact that I don't want to hurt you. I don't want to run you over. And two, a lot of times, especially when these cars come off the track, they're incredibly hot. They're 240, 260 degrees. The only thing we're worried about is getting to our pit stall so our teams can, you know, cool us down with the water bottles or something.
Yeah, and the thing people don't realize is, you know, like sprint cars, they don't have starters. They have to be push starters.
They lock the brakes up and they're done.
Yeah, I mean, even with us, like me, with a Power Glide with a direct drive on it, you can't just hit the brakes and, you know, the torque converter, you like sitting at a stoplight. You have to get it, throw it in the neutral, slow your momentum down, you know, and then get her back into gear. You know, if you got a clutch and a brake, that's just like normal driving. But these are not street cars. We just can't stop on a dime and start real easily. So, you know, people just got to pay attention. That's just ridiculous.
Yep, so stay out of the way. I'd like to hear some of your guys' comments about that. Does that really get on your nerves? You come into the pits, you're 240, 250 degrees, or you just come in after a good old-fashioned heat race and people are walking down the middle of the aisle? You know, what do you have to say about that?
Yeah, no kidding. And we want to hear from you. I want to know what pisses you off. I mean, we got Songer. He's pretty good at that. But I want to know what pisses you guys off, because we can't cover it all because we're all different people. But be sure to let us know. If something's ticking you off, let us know.
Tell you what, we'll be right back here on Slingin Dirt TV, presented by Joe's Karting.
Kaziski Auto Parts Team PRP, this is where everything starts with our quality control, staying clean, and everything is organized right here in the teardown. At Kaziski Auto Parts, in our step two process, this is where our guys take the engines and trannies out. They power wash and make sure everything tests good and clean so you have no problems for your vehicle.
This is step three at Kaziski Auto Parts. This is where everything again is organized, put on the shelf properly, tagged right. And if you notice how clean everything is, so that suits you, because we're not a junkyard, we are a recycled auto parts store.
This is our last and final step here. This is the shipping and receiving. This is the last part where the part gets checked one last time, so three people will touch your part before it goes out the door, packaged properly, and sent right to your door. Kaziski Auto Parts Team PRP. We have over 1,000 cars in stock a year, over 1,000 engines and trannies. Give us a call anytime, 402-731-4592. Any one of our 10 salesmen can help you at any time.
All right, welcome back to Slingin' Dirt TV, presented by Joe's Karting. Joe's Karting, your place to race, where the only restriction is how slow you go. And Jack here has got the all-time track record with 1 minute, 39.27 seconds a lap.
Yes.
Watching corn grow is faster than watching him go. So I tell you what, it's halfway through the season here. We've got about roughly 8-9 weeks left before we start getting into your specials, like the tradition, right, the classic, stuff like that. So what we wanted to do, we kind of wanted to go through Western Iowa, Eastern Nebraska, so grab a coffee, grab a beer, grab a whiskey, grab something, grab your wife, because we're going to be talking current point standings. And for you wives, you can grab your husbands too, if you want. I mean, so I'm just saying.
We had to
anyways,
go there.
Anyways, yeah, had to go there. So I tell you what, we're going to start in Iowa, and I'm going to go straight to Adams County Speedway. Now, keep in mind, these are the current point standings as we get them.
By the time you see the show, they're going to be a little different.
But this will give you an idea as who's going to be the top three, and we might mention some other names that may not be in the top three, but these are going to be predominantly top three. So the Stockler Chevrolet B-Mods out of Adams County, out of Corning, Iowa. Josh Most, is sitting in first, Jared Weston in the 86J second, and Ryan Jenkins number six. Do you know who Ryan Jenkins is?
I know the name, I don't know him personally.
You should know the name. He races against you at IED Weekly.
Well, probably he's in front of me, so I've
he's
never
a
seen
white
him.
Number six.
Okay, I know who you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah, now you know who I'm talking about. I tell you what, the nice thing about Josh Most, not a shocker being the track, you know, current points leader, Jared Weston, I've known Jared for a long time. He's a hard runner, super cool guy, super nice guy. You ever get a chance to go meet Jared Weston, go talk to him. He's an awesome guy. And his crew, you'd almost think it was like NASCAR. You'd think Jimmy Johnson's his, you know, Jimmy Johnson's pit crews. They're over there taking tire temps and writing notes. And I mean,
hey,
wow.
Nothing wrong with that. That's why they're up at the top of the standings.
As you go down though, I mean, I've seen guys like Dustin Shepherd, Josh Sink, Craig Garner, Brett Shepherd, Sean Harker's 14th, and we all know who Sean Harker is.
Yeah.
But you got little old Ryan Jenkins up there sitting third place. You know, and the cool thing about Adams County, and I wish all tracks did this, is they show you how many starts, wins, top fives, top tens.
Yeah, that is
I love that. If there's any one thing I can tell the racetracks, give us some stats like that on the website. Yeah, let us know how many top fives, top tens, wins, stuff right. like that. That's cool. In the chat mobility hobby stocks, Jeremy Purdy is sitting in first place. Andy Davidson, Davison second. Matt McAtee rounds out your top three. Matt McAtee, no surprise in being up there. In fact, all three of those guys makes perfect sense. Just in six starts, one's got two wins, one's got three, and Matt McAtee's got four top fives and five top tens. When you're running good like that, you're gonna be right up there. Now, one of the coolest things down at Corning is a late models. They have a great show in the late models there. Sterling Perkins is your current points leader. Paul Glendinning. When I seen Paul Glendinning, I've talked to him once or twice. He was a pretty nice guy. And the whole Glendinning name just stuck with me. Because
yeah,
I was like, can you imagine being drunk three sheets to the wind going, Glendinning. Sounds like you're on the red bloomer. Glendinning. Of course, number three, John Hample. John Hample, he's been there. I don't know what's been at Corning longer, the dirt or John Hample. It could be a toss-up. But, you know, those three guys, no big surprise there. Sterling and Paul both have a win. John's got two wins. So the top 3 points, not a shocker. Your pro stocks. Now, this is one, I love watching the results. I like watching Facebook. In your Northland Oil Pro Stocks, you've got Kevin Sharp, Brad Deary, and Greg Miller are your top three. Brad Deary runs the 37D out at IED in the stock car or whatever they're called out there, the Pro-Am.
The Pro-Am.
He's fast. And so when I'm watching Brad Deary sitting in second place, Kevin Sharp, you gotta be right up there. Greg Miller, he's been doing all right, but Kevin's got two wins, Brad and Greg's got one win. Once again, a ton of top fives and top tens. Now, six starts, you got two wins and one win, but when you've got five or six top fives and all six top tens,
hey,
that's all consistency.
I'm telling you, it's big just to finish on the podium, top four, whatever, get the tech.
Yeah.
Those nights make up for a lot of things.
Now, for your, and I hope I'm saying this right, POA Biorefining Modifieds. Another thing I like about Corning, and you don't see this at IED, or you don't always see this at Eagle, is they actually have the name of the sponsor.
Right.
So you know it's Northland Oil Pro Stocks.
Sure.
You know it's POET Biorefining Modifieds. I've always wondered what POET Biorefining is or does.
Maybe they read poetry and watch diesel
Maybe they
fuel.
Recycle Shakespeare.
There you go.
Recycled Shakespeare. So top three, no. Actually, I'm going to give a shout out to top four, and I'll tell you why here in a second. Fourth place, John Plowman, last year's national BMOD champion in NASCAR. To see him up there tossing around with the big boys, that is awesome. John Plowman, top four. Jeff Wiggins, don't know too much about Jeff. You've got Clint Holman out of Bellevue, Nebraska, rounding out second place. And this is a name that shouldn't shock you. In first place, Jesse Dennis.
Really?
Yeah, really. I mean, six starts, two wins, six top fives, six top tens. Plowman, here's, I just looked at this. Plowman has five starts, two wins, three top fives, and five top tens. And that's just in five starts in a rookie season in an A-mod. That's impressive.
It makes you wonder how they do that stuff. I don't know. You just got to be really talented.
I'm not for sure I could have that kind of a resume driving a sport compact my first year out.
I don't know. Well, I'll tell you what. We're going to go to Beatrice now. We're going to kind of bounce around here.
Yep.
And Beatrice,
Nebraska.
Nebraska, right. And we're going to start off with the modifieds. And you're all going to recognize these top three names. Hyatt, Sadoff, Bensberger. Please. Does anybody else have a chance, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, and then you got Blummer right behind that.
So. Josh Blummer. Yeah. I tell you what, though, if you ever got to know Josh, he's a really nice kid.
Oh, yeah.
He's out there to have fun, go race, he'll do anything.
I remember when we interviewed him under his car.
Yeah. You want to interview me anywhere here, right now?
Okay. And, you know, the surprising thing is those top three are separated by 6 points.
Wow.
Halfway through the season.
So just one little slip.
So, yeah, I mean, that's crazy. I mean, and then the list goes on, you know, Grabowski, Baker, you know, just name after name, you know, those guys.
The Beatrice has always had a stellar field of modifieds. They may not be getting the 50, 60 cars that other tracks get, but the cars that do show up can win on just about any given night in any given track.
I mean, they've got 26 listed, so it's not a gimme by any chance.
No.
And then we're going to go to the sport mods next, which Lance Borgman is leading the points at Beatrice.
Now, I've never met
Lance, but I know his name, and then you got Craig Evers and then Gary Sadoff, and, you know, we all know Gary.
Oh, yeah.
Another one of those tight races, you know, 6 points, again, top
wow.
three.
What's that say about the competition?
It's just amazing. I mean, we never really get a chance to sit down and look at it like this, so this is kind of fun for us, to be honest with you, instead of our normal grind, to actually kind of sit back and reflect on what the
yep.
season's doing, because it's like, holy crap.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to go to the stock IMCA stock cars next, which I always love watching these guys.
Oh, well, let me guess. Top three, Vanover's got to be up there.
Vanover's number one. You want to guess on number two?
No.
Gary Laughlin. Now, I don't know Gary.
Yeah, I don't know Gary.
And then we got Wade Wagenblast.
Ooh, Wade Wagenblast.
I don't know Wade either.
I tell you what kind of a stock car racing name is that? Wagenblast.
I don't know, but...
I'm going to Wagenblast your ass.
Yeah, what's your nickname is what I want to know. You know, and these guys are a little more spread out with points. Between the top two is 12 points right now, and then lagging back, you know, Wagenblast needs to put his blaster on the wagon and catch these guys, because he's only, you know, 18 out, so he can...
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's still...
There's plenty of season to make up ground on 18 points.
Sure. I mean, that is impressive to see how tight the points are at these tracks. And we got the Hobby Stalkers here at Beatrice, and... We got number one is Justin Rezabek. Do you know Justin? I don't. He's out of Wilbur. I don't know him personally.
No. Never got to meet Justin.
Brendan Steggy and Tyler Davis. These guys, the top two are separated by 4 points. And then...
Wow.
And then on back, between second and third is 5 points. And then coming in the strong fourth there is old Roy Armstrong. So you guys in the top three, you better watch out for Roy. And then Adam's back in sixth, so...
I don't see Adam finishing sixth in points.
No.
Adam's coming. I tell you what, though, ever since
But I tell you what, there's between sixth place and first place. Let's see, that's 63, 73. So that's 10. So you're talking 15 points between sixth place and first.
So they figure if you get... Well, yeah, all you got to do is finish in the back of the feature one night, and there's your...
You know, and this doesn't have the stats of, you know, wins and, you know.
And we, once again, we would
set.
Love
that
to
would
see.
Be nice, but because it kind of gives you the bigger picture of how this is going. But I'm telling you, DNFs
are huge.
Are huge. You know, that's terrible. You know, a DNF can totally just, with points that close, can ruin
yep.
your whole season. Sport compacts. Now, these guys are pretty close, too. 9 points separate first and second with Dylan Richards and Cole Critchow, you know, out of the Cronin Racing Stables there. He's doing really good for, you know, he's been an up-and-comer in the compacts, doing better and better each year, so
yep.
seeing him up at second kind of surprises me. Good job, Cole. And then you got Jeremy Jensen in third and Larry Cronin in third, you know, so you're talking 19 points.
I don't know if it's just me. It seems like the Cronin name is getting to be bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger in the sport compacts. I was wondering, how many sport compacts is there in the point standings, roughly? 15?
16.
How many are Cronins? 10 of them?
I'm sure there's three.
Oh, at least. Mary... Or is there a Mary Cronin?
No.
Larry Cronin, Erica Cronin, Melissa Cronin. You might as well
actually,
put Cole
actually, it
in
looks
there.
Like only the guys are racing at Beatrice out of the Cronin plant.
Oh. Okay. All right.
But if you threw all the girls in there too, there'd probably be five of them, I think.
At least.
Yeah.
So. All right. I tell you what, we're going to bounce back over to Iowa. We'll go to a little track. Now, you're going to laugh at this. We're going to mention Clark County Speedway. Now, Clark County Speedway, like you were mentioning Beatrice, the DNFs are huge. When you have a close points race, you can't DNF, and you certainly don't want to finish in the back of the pack. Mm-hmm. You got to run hard. Now, with Clark County Speedway, they don't have the exuberant car numbers. You don't see the exuberant superstars. But to say that their drivers can't compete would be a gross understatement. They've got good drivers there. They run their program a little different. They're not sanctioned, but they only run every other Saturday night. Mm-hmm. So like in June, the end of May, beginning of June, I think there was two nights where we rained out. So when you only get to race every 2 weeks and
you
rain out.
And then you have rainouts, boy, DNFs are huge.
DNFs are huge, and almost just as tough as a DNF is finishing in the back of the pack. But to go through Clark County Speedway's deal, in the Outlaw Hobby Stocks, Chris Onstead out of St. Charles, Iowa, he's in first. Ryan Went and Darren Went. I'm going to assume, by the way their last names are spelt, they're brothers. They are tied with 113 points, but from third to first, it's separated by 6 points. And so when you race every other Saturday night and we have a rainout, that's cruel. I mean, you really have to drive aggressive. Now, when I say aggressive, they're not out there beating and banging and rolling in cars either. Now, Germer in the Clark County B-Mods, use your current points there, two-time track champion, it doesn't surprise me. Jason Mason, now here's a kid that's coming on. You and I went to Clark County, he drives a 6M. He was really, I'm not gonna say struggling, but he was getting his program where it needed to be, and he's right up there now. Chase Rudolph is third place, I'm fourth, but that first week kind of screwed me when I finished ninth. But you know, once again, normally, you know, last year, I think with two or three nights left to go, I was sitting second in points. And then we had some rainouts last year.
Right.
You know, so when you don't get those nights to get points, it hurts.
I think we get the point.
Yep. So Crawford County Speedway, the Pro 4 trucks, probably one of the funnest classes I've ever seen.
That is cool. When I saw that was just, I almost said, I want to do that. I want to drive.
I got to do it one time, and surprisingly, the trucks are very stable, and they're a blast to drive. Just a blast to drive.
To me, they look like a cross between like a hobby stock and, you know, kind of a tuner, but you know, the smaller trucks are not full-size trucks.
Yeah, these are like S10s, Ford Rangers, Dakotas.
They were fun to watch.
It's one of the coolest classes I've ever seen. Garrett McKee out of Indianola, Iowa is your points leader, followed by Garrett Nelson and Kyle Berg rounding up your top three. 5 points separates the top three. Once again, you don't get that. You get a rainout, ooh, that hurts. Your front-wheel drive street stocks. Dean Richards, Joshua Camden and Logan Richards, your top three, 5 points separate.
Man,
yeah,
tight point racing, boy.
The junior front wheel drive. Now, this is kind of a cool class. This isn't your 11, 12, and 13-year-old kids, and they only race against kids their age. There's only three in the point standings. Now, this was as of 6/27, so the 28th and 29th didn't count yet. There's only three of them, but once again, only 5 points separate them. So yeah, it's now by far and away one of the coolest classes, if not the biggest class. Well, it is the biggest class. Is the Mike Max Sprint.
Yeah.
Now these guys get after. If you are
chainsaws with wings.
Yeah, chainsaws with wings. Yeah, that's a good way of putting it. It really is. Now there's kind of a big points gap here. First place, Eric Bridger out of Winterset, Iowa. Second place is Hunter Lane, and third is Ben Woods. 233 points to 215 to 208. But when you get down to third is separated from fourth by 5 points, and fourth is separated by fifth by 6-7 points. So it's a very, very tight points race. But Clark County Speedway, probably one of the biggest hidden gems, I think, in Iowa. Doesn't get a big car count.
No,
it's a fun track.
It's one of those things, if you've never been on a quarter mile dirt track, it blew my mind when I went there. I was like, holy crap, this is like doing.
Remember how we said you drive? 1, 2, 3, lift.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3, lift.
It's definitely different. So if you ever get a chance to go there, you need to do it. Just at least one time just to say
one time,
it.
Yeah.
And nice people too. They're totally accommodating. Yes. Same way in pits. People help you out. They know you're new there. They'll just come over and let you know. Well, we're going to go to Eagle Raceway next.
Oh, America's favorite home track.
Yeah, America's favorite home track.
Or badass track, or whatever they call it.
It's a hell of a track. Hey, we're going to start off with the hobby stocks, and it's no surprise who's 1 and 2.
I'm going to say his name, his initials are AA.
Yeah, AA and RA, the Armstrongs, are 1 and 2, and they're separated by 2 points. So father-son duo there. And then Tyler Sadoff is in third, and he's 23 out. So there's a little gap in there. But then between fourth and third, you know, Justin Busboom, which Justin, I used to race with him back in the compact days, and he moved up to the hobbies, and he's been tearing it up because there's some tough guys out there in a big field.
There's tough guys in every class in that field.
You know, their field, I mean, their field in, here, how many pages do I need to go through? There's
three?
You know, 8 guys tied in 46th in points, you know? That should tell you something. So, you know, the hobby stocks, I like watching those guys. They kick some butt. Then we're going to go to the A-Mods. Now, A-Mods at Eagle, there's no defined champion all the time.
No.
Back 5 years ago, you know, Alcorn would run away with it for 2 or 3 years, and another guy would run away for 2 or 3 years.
You'd have an Abelson, or you'd have a Dylan Smith.
Yeah, you know, those
and
guys.
And now you don't know who's.
Well, a lot of those guys are traveling and doing different stuff, so we see a little bit different names up here. But, you know, Chad Anderson, you know, out of Omaha, he's in first. And then you got Johnny Sadoff, you know, the Jet.
Do
we need to say anything else, you know? He's only 5 behind him. Then you got Shane Hyatt, and Shane's been having a hell of a year.
Shane's been having a hell of a year, but Chad Anderson, if you go back, he's always been a good competitive racer, but I think this could
be his best season ever.
I'd like to get him on the show and interview him about this year.
Absolutely. Yeah, and like Shane, he's been just tearing it up. I've been watching him, kind of follow him on Facebook a little bit, see how he's doing.
Shane's a perennial upfront runner. If you see Shane at a racetrack, you can probably guarantee he's going to be a top 5. For sure a top 10, but probably a top 5.
Yeah, he's always top 10, unless just something happens, you know. But yeah, I mean, you've taken those three right there, 13 points, and fourth place is 14 out, you know.
Yeah.
Jared Hoffman, you know, it's like, wow.
I used to race against Jared Hoffman in the B mods, and he was good in the B mods.
I can tell you who's running last.
Wow.
Yeah. I know.
So how many A mods do we have?
36.
36 A mods in the points game.
Yes.
Wow.
And then we're going to go to the Sport Compacts now. Sport Compacts, you know.
How many do we have? About 120?
It's great, but here's some more familiar names, you know, we were talking about earlier over at Beatrice, but you got Kevin Fearing in first, and then you got Cole Critchell, you know, out of the Cronin stables there, he's in second, and you got Melissa Cronin in third, and actually first and second are tied right now, as of what we have in front of us, they're tied. So Cole has been tearing it up.
Yeah, these are as of June 27th.
You know, so they've been tearing it up down there, and in fourth is Spencer Peavy, and he's only 5 out. And then you go to fifth, 10 out.
Yeah. You don't really see a big gap until you hit sixth place.
Those compacts, those guys are running.
I've always thought the compacts at Eagle were one of the best shows to watch.
I mean, that's where I started out racing, and you know, back when they first started that class up, I mean, it was a lot of fun. But there was always a full field. Even when they first started, there was 20 cars there every night.
At least.
And
60 now?
Yeah. A lot.
A lot.
And then we're gonna go to Sport Mods, you know.
Oh boy.
And these guys, and I think out of all the classes, the Sport Mods is the class that's exploded in class size. I mean, there's 58, and there's probably 10 more guys underneath it that are all tight and
70
cars, and they feel 40, 50, 60 cars on any given night. But you know, to be number one, Benji Legg. I mean, there's a name we're not, you know. He's always up top. Trent Roth.
Trent Roth is having a pretty good year. Here's the guy.
Here's the guy that I that
love this guy. Adam Verbka.
Adam.
Third place. Come on, Adam.
Yep, I've been cheering him on all year. Adam and I used to race. He's another one of those compact
and
racers.
And he's such a nice kid, too. He is. You go up to him and he... Now, everybody says everything about everybody out there in the rumor mill, but when I've talked to Adam, which hasn't been a lot, but when I have, he's always been really nice. He's never really trash talked anybody. He just goes out there.
He quietly does his business.
He just quietly does his business. You know, he's gotten into people. People have gotten into him, but he doesn't
bitch. Him and I have gotten into each other.
He doesn't bitch. He doesn't complain, moan, groan. He doesn't do anything.
No.
He's a really good kid to
talk to. Quick story about Adam, and this is one my wife and I always remember. I can remember the first time he came out to the track, and he was so nervous. And here's this, I think he was probably 14, 15 years old at the time. Here's this kid with this nice mullet, you know? Not a skullet, a mullet. And he would sit in his car for like 30 minutes before his race and just sit there and just meditate.
Or,
I don't know what he was doing, but he wasn't sleeping because his eyes were open. But look at him now. He's all grown up and, you know, third place at Sport Mods.
Yeah, I did not expect that because, I mean, right behind that you got Mark Lining, Sean Harker,
Gary Sadoff, you know,
Lance Boardman. But Adam Burka running third, good man.
Yeah,
good job,
Adam.
Wow.
That's impressive. And then we got the sprints, the 305s, and this fairly new class, but here's the name that you used to see in the 360s all the time tearing up was Doug Lovegrove, and he's up in first place, which Doug had some tough years, you know, and then he decided to go down to the 305s and stick with Eagle. And I've always been a Lovegrove fan because he was always a 44 car.
Oh.
So, you know, you gotta have love the
loyalty.
Yeah, there's and he's in first with 202 points. Then you got Trevor Grossenbacher, no surprise.
Yep.
Another up-and-comer out of the tuner
class,
Joey Danley, tearing
it
up.
Well, I say from tuner to sport mod. Sport mod, he was really good in the sport mod.
Mm-hmm.
And then with the Danley name, he went in. It was just a matter of time. It wasn't a matter of if. It was a matter of when he was going to go to sprint cars. And I tell you what, Joey Danley has put on some hellacious runs.
Oh, he's,
I mean, he's awesome.
Every time he goes out, he gets better and better and better. I mean, he was a
he's a young kid, but he's like a 50-year-old Scotch. He just gets better with time.
Yeah, and he's got, you know, the whole support system behind him, too, to make him good and kind of give him pointers. I mean, he was track champion in the tuners.
I'll guarantee you within 10 years, you see a championship.
I wouldn't doubt that.
For sure, within 10 years, 5 years, very possible. You'll see a championship with Danley.
Well, he's only 8 points out of first. It might be this year.
It might be this year.
I mean, and look at the names behind him. You know, Adam Gillian, Clint Benson, national champion. You know. Behind you.
Terry Richards.
Mike Boston. Come on.
Shaley Bate.
Yeah. I mean, these guys, Boston was like track champion like 1,000 times at Eagle.
They might as well just rename the sprint car championship the Boston Memorial.
You know, and a lot of, you know, these guys are 360 drivers that went to the 305.
Yep.
You know, so, I mean, geez, there's just crazy stuff going on at Eagle. And let me tell you, it is a great show at Eagle. They put on great stuff, Roger Hayden and his whole crew down there. If you want to see how you measure up, you think you're
good,
all that,
go to Eagle.
Yep, because you'll find out real quick where you measure up.
So I tell you what, we're going to bounce back over to Iowa. We're going to go to Crawford County Speedway. Now, you liked Denison.
I did. I love Denison.
Yep. Now, here's the nice thing. Once again, Denison does the stats for us, but they only do the top 10. For points. Now, this was as of, this is off their website. So, in the modifieds, top three, Shane the Maiden, Kid Smooth. Second place, the racer, Ricky Steffen. In first place, Mr. Excitement himself, Chris Abelson, who's going for another national championship run this year.
Go, Chris.
Go, Chris. It doesn't say how many starts, but he's got 3 wins, 4 top 5s, 4 top 10s, 4 features, so 4 starts. But second place, Ricky Steffen, 6 points out.
He had a win the other day.
Yeah, he did. I seen
that.
And then you got a 30-point split down to Shane DeMay. Now, sport mods, this is no shocker here. First and second, you got Keegan and Logan Scott. Third place, Jake Sacco. But the points, there's 2 points separating second from first and 5 from third to first. Once again, even fourth place, Tim Judd. 15-point split, so plenty of racing.
Yeah.
Now, listen to this, hobby stocks. Jason Cole, the 27, runs at Eagle every now and then. He's first. Chuck Madden is second. Kevin Bruck is third. But Jason Cole has only got a 1-point advantage over Chuck Madden and Kevin Bruck. 1 point separate the top three.
Boy, get her done.
And then fourth place, Justin Nearing, And fifth place, Sterling Sorensen, are out by 15 points. So that is, wow, that is
some
tight.
Low stuff.
Yep. You go back to the stock cars, now these two names, by far and away, don't shock me. I don't know how well you know these guys, but first place, Mike Nichols.
Yeah.
Five-time national champ. Where do you think he's going to get the points? Flying Brian Blessington. That guy's won more championships than anybody I know outside of Mike Nichols. So, 9-point difference. And then you got Adam Clokey, I hope I pronounced that right. He's 13 points out, top three. And then you got fourth place, Mike Stapleton, who we interviewed on the show. He's fourth place. And he's 23 points out. And then in the sport compacts, looks like Alex Stapleton is first place.
Right.
Followed by Cody Thompson. And then, oh boy, third place, Eric Schneckloff. I hope I could. How do you think you pronounce that name?
Close enough.
Close enough. Eric Schneckloff. You know, he's third place in points. He's 12 points out. So,
yeah.
What you were saying, I mean, to really watch this tight points racing.
Yeah.
Wowee.
I mean, I don't usually pay attention to the point standings as far as other tracks and things like that. You know, of course, we always look at our own just to see how much I suck, but. You know,
yep.
It's what you do, you know, but it's just kind of interesting and fun to actually do this mid-season. And then, you know, at the end of this season, of course, we're going to probably do a show with all, you know, all the track champions and stuff like that.
The national champs and stuff.
Well, yep. We're going to go to our backyard over here at I-80 Speedway. And we're going to start off with the super late models. And no surprise, who's number one there? The old missile, Tad Pospisil.
Oh, yeah. Todd.
Yep, and Matt Butler and Ken Schaefer, and I mean, you're talking 8 points between the top three, and then you got Andrew Kosicki in fourth, 12 out, 18 to fifth,
I mean,
18
eight,
to sixth. I mean,
you're,
gosh.
You're down here 18 to sixth. I mean, you still got enough time this season to go from sixth to
oh,
know.
Heck yeah.
You know, and just, you look up there, you got Corey Zeitner, Jace Kaser,
yeah.
Andrew. So that's a champion, champion, champion,
yeah.
Champion, champion. I mean, good God, the amount of, the level of competition in that
isn't that crazy? Okay, we're going to go to I-80, back to the A-Mods here, and, you know, no surprise that the name's up here, you know, Dennis, Hoffelman, and Holman, Larkin.
Jesse Dennis.
You know.
How far out is Jesse Dennis in the points?
He's actually 36 up on second place, so out of all the tracks we've talked about so far, he probably has the biggest lead out of anybody.
You know how many points you get in an IMCA feature?
No.
You get 40 points for a win. I-80 is NASCAR section,
right.
So it's a little bit different. I think you get like 100 points for a win.
Right.
So even though he's 36 points out.
Right, you can suck it up quick. If
very. All he's got to do is have one bad night and he's lost the points lead. You were 36 points out.
I mean, yeah. Back to third is 52 out, 54, you know. So those guys are you know.
Scott Carlson, Porky, he's up there.
Yep.
Lieutenant Dan.
Lieutenant Dan, yeah.
You know, if you get off the shrimp boat, Lieutenant Dana might be able to.
But see,
to
like you see names like, you know, Hyatt and Grabowski and those guys, they're lower in the points, but
they're not
running there. They're running, you know, just to have some fun. You know, and then, okay, we're going to have the sport mods. No surprise, Harker's number one. He's been killing everybody, but, you know, we're at the track and we race with this guy, and you know, it seems like he's always one, two, or three, but he's only 6 points, you know.
The one thing about Harker is he is so. Smooth.
He is smooth.
You never see the car twitching and pitching and rolling and yawing.
No.
He just comes through the corner, looks like he's out for a Sunday drive. It's just so smooth on the throttle.
Yeah, we got Scott Siskel out of David City. He's six behind Harker. Ryan Jenkins out of Omaha. Dennis Cook, you know, he's 50 out. So.
He's last year's track champ.
Yeah. So, I mean, all these guys, and then there's me, 12th. Let's see where Buddy Ray is.
Ha!
You're not on here. Oh, you are. You're 14th, so you're there and you're coming back. So that's since our last race. So.
Well, I like to be a good sportsman, so you've never raced I-80 Speedway, so I'm gonna let you have, you know, kind of a
it's kind of like
start.
Opening the door for me. Say, here you go.
Yeah, here you go.
All right, then we're gonna go to the stock cars. You know,
Pro-Am.
Yeah. Brad Derry. That guy's always fast. He's one of the guys, I don't know him,
yeah.
But I always watch
he's
him.
He's a really cool guy. You go down and talk to him. He's funny. He's done the victory lane dance. He's actually won a national championship in this class.
Yeah, and Tim Pedroza.
Pedroza,
Scotty Hartman. I mean, 26. Jim Hendricks, 28 points. I mean, come on, 28 points from fourth to first.
Look at, you know, like I said, I think it's 100 points you get for a feature win. So in order to find your 100 points play, you got to go clear down to ninth place.
Yeah.
On any given night, anything could happen. I mean, so when you see 22, 26, 28, a lot of, some people are going to go, well, that's a pretty big split, but no, it's not.
No,
it no, isn't. No.
And that's true. I never really looked at it that way because I don't really pay attention to it, except when they give you points for not even running. So, another show. Anyways, and a shout out to Tim Drake out of hometown there in Murray, Nebraska. Way to go. And then we're going to go to the Grand Nationals here. These lists just go on and on of these big names. Billy Coons, you know, Dave Cook,
yeah.
Jake Bridge. 1, 2, 3.
Dave Cook.
You know, yeah, Dave Cook.
That's the owner of DirtDrivers.com.
Yep. Yeah, I mean, these guys, 60 points from fourth to first. That is just impressive. And these guys race hard, too. I love watching these guys.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
You'll see these guys sometimes 3 wide on the very bottom of the track with
yeah.
3 more lanes on the high side wide open.
Yep. Yeah. Another shout out to hometown boy Kurt Drake there. You know, you guys, Drake boys are doing
good. Kurt Drake, he's always been a great guy to yeah. talk to.
Hornets now.
Hornets.
These guys, I love watching these,
yeah.
and part of it is we have some vested interests.
Well, you, yeah,
we
you have got yeah, history in the class.
Yeah.
I want to drive one time.
I want to see you in one because I think you'd be surprised at how hard they actually are to drive. Tammy Clark and Lindsey Tyson, those two have been swapping the lead back and forth all year. And then you got Dennis Kennedy. Between the two girls up front, 6 points. That's it.
Wow.
That's nothing in our point system. And then you got Dennis Kennedy and then Andrew Kuva at 60 out in fourth place. I mean, that's pretty impressive. And these guys put on a heck of a show out there. They're a lot, they're really fun to watch. And they just got a lot of guts, you know. You just see it out there.
Yep.
You know, it's great. So that's I-80 Speedway. More tight racing.
All right, so we're going to go back over very quickly, finish up 2 tracks in Iowa, Shelby County Stewart. We're going to start with Shelby County Speedway out of Harlan, Iowa. In the Bombers, it's a new class this year. Terry Irwin, Dave Archibald, and Alex Davis round out your top three. Now, we go back to 40 points for a win. Terry Irwin is just putting a butt-whooping on him. He's 70 points up in the lead. So.
Okay, yeah, that's
But
that's
I think that because it's such a new class, the second, third place cars hadn't got out there on the first 1 or 2 weeks, maybe, I don't know. Now this was as of June 27th. Your hobby stocks, Jason Cole, Kevin Brooks, Shannon Anderson round out your top three. Jason Cole, of course, was a track champion there. Kevin Brooks, he's back in a hobby stock this year. He's loving that hobby stock. And Shannon Anderson, a 5-time national IMCA hobby stock champion. But you go back to Brandon Baker out of Omaha, Nebraska. He's tied with Shannon in fourth place. 11 points separate third and fourth from the lead in the points. That's impressive.
Mm-hmm.
You go out, we're going to go to late model. Late model, Todd Cooney, Jay Stewart, and the 8-ball, Dave Livingston.
Way to go, Coonster.
So, with a car number like 8-ball, and Alan Hopp is fourth in points, does that mean he goes, man, I got to do something, I'm behind the 8-ball? So
don't quit your day job.
Yeah. Todd Cooney, he's got an 18-point lead over Jay Stewart. Dave Livingston in third place, he's 22 points out of the lead. Todd Cooney, not a big surprise, running up front, Jay Stewart. The Alan Hopp, if it's who I think it is, I was there the night I raced there with my sport mod. He won, and it was probably one of the coolest feature finishes I'd ever seen. It looked like Jay Stewart were just going to walk away with it. Last lap, turn 4, Hop did this amazing move on the high side, got a hell of a run, and I think he got Stewart by maybe 6 inches right at the start-finish line. It was almost like Stewart knew he had it, and maybe he backed off just a fuzz, not realizing it, and Hop got him. But it was, I mean, everybody in the stands, pits, whatever, you were on your feet when I came. Modifieds, top three. Chris Abelson, Travis Hatcher, and Steve Reet. Man.
Hey, Reet.
Yeah. I guess that's what happens when you eat 50-pound bags of sweet pea. You know, good old goat coming up third place. That's awesome. 68 points out. Travis Hatcher out of Council Wells, Honey Creek, Iowa area. 14 points out. And then, of course, Chris Abelson. Shocker, shocker.
Yeah, big news
yep.
there.
In your Northern Sport Mod, top three, third place, actually, third place, second, third, or tie, 29 points out from the leader, Dylan Peterson and Brett Hopp, and then Clint Llewellyn, the Minburn Missile.
He has been tearing it, though.
He is good. And I know I make everybody sound like to be the good guy in racing, but Clint Llewellyn is just one of the most humble, down-to-earth people.
For a
young racer that wins a lot, it'd be really easy. I mean, my God, I can get cocky and arrogant at times.
What?
Rolling up with
you don't even know what the definition of humble is. Moving on.
So, but moving on, Clint Llewellyn is such an awesome guy to talk to and know. Sport Compacts, first, second, third, you get the 25 of Cody Thompson, the 87 of Taylor Griffin, and third place, the 15 MC of Tyler Thompson. 14 and 15 points separate third to first. Yeah, 15 points from third to first. And then stock cars, top three, Keith Knopp, 12 points out. Actually, this is probably the tightest points race. Fifth place, Flying Brian Blessington, he's 19 points out. And then you got JJ Bromley, something like that. He's 14 points out. Third place is 12 points out. 10th place, Devin Smith out of Lake City, Iowa. He's 10 points out. Points leader, Mike Nichols. Shocker. Yeah, so shocker there. And then real quick on Stewart Speedway. If you ever get a chance to go to Stewart, I'm actually gonna go there today. I'm gonna interview Chuck Vanderhyde. Great facility, great track. We've been hearing about all the terrain, tracks are cornfield rough, choppy. Yeah. This place is smooth like a baby's bottom and goes dry slick every week. Late models, top three, John Emerson, Todd Cooney, Paul Nagel. Looks like there's maybe a 5-point difference between the top three.
Get on her, Cooney.
Get on her, Cooney. Come on, get on her like a windshield donut or something. So, modifieds. Top three, Jeff Joldersma. Here's a guy. That's that 66 car.
Yep.
He's really fun to watch.
Yep.
Really fun to watch. You got Luke Wanniger out of Minburn, Iowa. Good friends with Clint Llewellyn. And then the kid, Nick Roberts, out of Des Moines, Iowa. Nick Roberts, helping Chad Weirs up at Weirs Machinery. Hope they paid Chad a lot of money to babysit Nick. Just kidding, Nick. You're good.
Yeah, right.
So, stock cars. Top three, Brian Blessington. Yeah, Blessington out of Breda, Iowa, followed by Josh Daniels, Marcus Fagan out of Adair, Iowa. Looks like 11, 12 points separate that. Sport mods, Cody Havens, the 99K out of Wyota, Iowa. 20 point split between third and first. Cody Havens, Dustin Mussolini. That sounds like an artist name, like, welcome to the Mussolini.
Yeah, he looks like a rookie, too.
Yeah, and so a rookie.
Second place, rookie.
Second
good
place,
job.
10 points out of Clint Llewellyn. So that's pretty good. And then our buddy Ari Scott, he's down there in seventh place.
Ari.
I think he missed a night, though, because he went to Eagle and got tore up. So if you would have had that.
Surprise, surprise.
Yeah. Not on Ari's fault. So we're not knocking Ari. Hobby Stocks, Austin Llewellyn. Here's a kid that's really been turning up the heat this year.
He has.
Wow.
Been following him, too.
Yep, John Watson and Buck Sheffroff out of Orient, Iowa. You gotta love the name of some of these racers.
Yeah, they are. Yeah.
It looks like maybe a 5-point difference between the top three. And then last but not least, your Sport Compacts, Randy Rush. Can you imagine if Randy had a girlfriend or wife? His opening line would be like, can you feel the rush?
You're such a moron.
Jacob Peters out of Bondurant, Iowa, and Jacob Ryder out of Des Moines, Iowa. Round out, that's your top three. Jacob Ryder got 186 points. Randy Rush, he's got 175, so a 9-point difference there.
Yeah.
Tell you what, though, you've said it several times as we did this recap of the season around here, the amount of close points racing. But yes.
It's incredible.
With the amount of rainouts that we have, you ain't got time to screw around.
And that's a very good point. The amount of rainouts we've had has made it tighter because we've got a limited number of races to get them in. So, DNFs are huge.
Yeah, I mean, there's the Clark County Speedway. It's got the smallest schedule of any track I know out there. It's got 11 nights, but we've already rained out 2, 3. So now I've only got, on 11 nights minus 2. They get, prior to this last Saturday night, that was 9 nights. You've got to make a move in 9 nights. You ain't got no room.
No messing around.
You got to get on the ball.
Yep.
So I tell you what, this has been Slingin' Dirt. We're going to go talk to one of our sponsors. We're going to get a drink. We'll be right back.
Hey, welcome back to Slingin Dirt, brought to you by Joe's Karting. We're here today with our tech tip of the day, and we're going to talk about toe plates and setting your toe. This is going to be a short and sweet, here, moron. Short and sweet. If you don't have a set of these, get them. They're not that expensive, and they'll save you a lot of hassle.
Well worth it.
Yeah, and if you're trying to do this by yourself, it can really, really, really help you. If you have two people, it's even better. But basically, all these do is they're going to set against your tires. Front tire, front tire. And what you're going to do is take a tape measure, and you're going to measure the front of the tire and the back of the tire. And the advantage of these are is that it's accurate every time. I mean, a lot of us, even me, I'm sure you have too, has measured tire tread and had your crew chief or whatever on the other side, and he's holding the other end, and then one of you is moving tie rod ends to do it. These just give you a little more accuracy. I'm not going to say they're a necessity, but they're definitely something that if you don't have for the price, you're crazy.
Yeah, the one thing I do want to tell everybody, a lot of times, this is what I see in the pits, they'll have their tire. Let's say that this is the sidewall of a tire. Here's the number one thing I see. They're down like this, or they're like this. You got to make sure that this flat part is up against the tire. We don't have a tire in here to show you. But make sure it's from that these toe plates from here to here go across the face of the tire and they're upright. And then when you check your toe out, I don't know what everybody does, but I would think all the rear wheel drive cars, you want your right front to be toed out as you're going. If this is your right front, you're towed out, you're going into the corner, it's going to help set the car when you turn accordingly. And when you do set the toe, and correct me if I'm wrong, you'll run your tape measure across. You want the front measurement to be bigger than the rear measurement. If the rear measurement is bigger, you got toe in, and that's generally not what you want to do. Yeah. And when it comes to toe out, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that you have to run. It comes down to what is comfortable for the driver. It's your preference. I can
what
tell you
what class you're running. There's a lot of different variables.
And it's 4 miles. We'll run a quarter inch, but on the half mile tracks, I'm liable to run eighth inch.
And sometimes I've ran as much as half inch in a compact, and 3/8 on it. The other thing with these toe plates too is when you guys, we all got camber in our front wheels. You need to make sure that these plates are against the tire so the camber and the plates are reading exactly the same. It should be tied up against the tire, not like that. Your tire's cambered. Boom.
If what I do, and I don't know if you noticed this when we worked on your car, my car, if you've got a bunch of wiggle, it ain't tight.
Nope.
You should go up there nice, snug, firm, and not wobble around.
All right, well, that pretty much sums it up. This isn't rocket science, and every car does it. If you don't check your toe in or you don't use it, you need to. It'll make you faster, or get with somebody that is fast and they'll give you some pointers. Tuners, they're different than everybody else. If you're having problems with towing, feel free to call me. Ask Lindsay Tyson. She knows now. Things are different on tuners than everybody else. But anyways, that's your tech tip of the week. We'll be right back after a word with our sponsors. Would you like to see your ad right here on Slingin Dirt TV? You need money, we need money. So if you want to sponsor an ad on Slingin Dirt TV,
email me at buddyj@joeskarting.com. It's B-U-D-D-Y, letter J at joeskarting.com, karting with a K. Gain some traction, become a winner by putting your sponsorship right here. Welcome back to Slingin Dirt TV. It's that time of the week. We're just going to cut to the chase. Here it is. Songer Says.
All right, so I put a post out there of subjects for Songer Says. And I was kind of looking for some stuff to rant and rave about because some of mine have gotten a little too serious and not as much fun. But I had a fan or a viewer or whatever you might want to call them give me one heck of an idea and subject. So before I go any further, because I've ripped on sanctioning bodies and officials quite a bit, so this is not to rip on, it is an idea, and they may be doing something similar to it already. But the subject came up of fines and where that money goes. Where do sanctioning body fines go to? Say you got to pay a $1,000 fine or $250 or a $500 or a $5,000 or whatever it might be. Where does that fine money go to? Well, this person brought up a pretty good subject of where we could, and maybe the sanctioning bodies already do something. I don't want to sit here and knock on them on a subject I know nothing about. But she brought up a pretty good subject. Now we've revealed it was a she. But she said, as high school seniors and you're a race car driver, you really don't play probably a lot of sports, so you don't really have a avenue for scholarships. And as a racing community, we would love to keep I love the young guys coming up through. That's the great part of the sport. That's the only way we keep the sport alive, is keeping the young guys going. So why not do some kind of a scholarship for seniors in high school that race? Maybe each state, divide it into a state, divide it into however you want to divide it, doesn't matter. Or just give one or two of them away for the whole sanctioning body. You have to send in a video of your accomplishments. What now, as you can see as I bounce around in all my jiggly jiggly jiggles, yes, I am on 6569 Highway 5 bypass. Only in Des Moines, Iowa do you give 9 names to a freaking road. But why not have them fill out a video or a paragraph or a page or whatever that of their accomplishments, what they've done in school, what they do for the community, and maybe make a contest out of it. You know, it wouldn't have to have anything to do with wins, just as long as they participate in racing on a weekly basis or monthly or whatever you might want to do, and, you know, be somewhat of a good citizen. And then they would be eligible for said scholarship. Because fines, I don't think they make a ton of money off fines, but they probably make somewhere between, I'm guessing, $10,000 and $12,000 a year on fines nationwide. So it's not a ton, but, you know, it was just an idea to take the money from a bad situation and hopefully make it into a good situation, which maybe we should give some money to the Iowa Department of Transportation to fix this damn road. But I thought that was a really, really good idea, because, like I said, the only way you're going to keep this sport going is the young kids. And if there was a reward for them racing, you know, then maybe that would help too. And we don't want them just to be race car drivers. We'd love to see them all get educations and all that. So I think finally we've had a productive Songer Says, and I hope that this doesn't fall on deaf ears and, you know, somebody gives some thought to it.
You know, with Songer Says, we've always said it. We don't know what he's going to be talking about, but we both agree he's always point on.
Mm-hmm.
We've never asked this, and I'm curious. What are some of your favorite Songer Says videos that Songer has done? What are some of your favorite ones? And what are some of the subjects you would like to see him talk about? Let us know here on Facebook or on YouTube, or just give me a shout out at buddyj@joeskarting.com and I'll forward that info on to Jamie Songer. But we know a lot of you, you know, like listening to Jamie, so I'm just kind of curious what your favorite thing is. Now, the fan of the week.
Yep.
Good question, and I'm actually having to go back through my memory files, is how fast, Aaron wants to know, how fast do we get going on the track? Well, it depends, because when you say track, that's a pretty vague statement.
This is
true. Because we have dry slick tracks, We have
different size tracks.
Different size tracks. We have sticky, hammered down, tacky tracks. Yeah. And then we have cornfields. And it's not about how fast you go, it's how fast you bounce.
And the other thing is we really don't know how fast we're going at the time, because we don't have speedometers like you have in your regular car.
No, I can break out the math, but it's too early on a Monday morning for me to break out the math with gear ratio and tire circumference and all that. I can tell you that it was 2014. I went to the Silver Dollar Nationals, which I will not be there this year. I've already had a lot of people ask me, "You coming out at the Nationals?" Nope, my wife put her foot down and I'm going camping.
You need to take care of your wife.
Yep. So, anyways, 2014, I took a radar gun out there. I was clocking Jimmy Owens, the Newport Nightmare. I was clocking him going into the turn three at 127 mile an hour. It was impressive.
Yeah, and that's another thing too, is speed is relative, because most of these tracks with our transponders, they keep track of your lap time and your lap, average speed was. But when you're barreling down a straightaway, I mean, just say I-80, you know, in a sport.
It's not real hard for us to hit.
Hit 100 miles an hour, I'm guessing, close to that.
Actually, no.
Don't think so?
Nope, I know for a fact.
I don't know. See, that's just it. You don't know.
What I was noticing
is, I know average speeds are in the 90s.
Now Thursday night when I was there, I was watching the guys practicing the Lucas Oil late models at 127 mile an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course you had the USMTS guys there that were, a couple were camping, and they were practicing on the Thursday night show. And you and I will be racing that Thursday night program this year as well, because that's a weekly points race for
right.
us. But I want to say it was Jason Crone, 117 mile an hour. The Sport Mods came in at 88 or 90 mile an hour.
Really? See,
down
there
the straightaways.
You go. Yeah, that, you just don't know.
The Sport Compacts are right at 60 mile an hour. But I tell you what, while you can sit here and say, well, the Lucas Oil late models are going 127 mile an hour, you're telling us, bud, and the Sport Compacts are, they're only doing 60. Yeah. You go jump in a car and go do 60 on dirt and make it stick and see how easy that is.
And then put 20 other idiots just like yourself around you.
Yeah.
And
but that's on a half mile track. Now right. You go out to Eagle Raceway. I do like this about Eagle Raceway. I think if you go to mylaps.com, it'll show you the event and you can get to see the average. But what they're showing you is not, the straightaway speeds will always be higher than the average
speed.
So in the A mods, it's not uncommon to see 85, 90 mile an hour in the A mods. What they're not telling you is what the straightaway speed is. To me, you know, yeah, in circle track racing, it's all about how fast you get through the corners. But to me, it shows driver confidence and driver ability. When I can say, well, I know Johnny Sadoff's going 110 mile an hour in straightaway, and then he plants it into the corner, which is gonna automatically drop your speed down, but you're still averaging 80 miles an hour. So I've always been intrigued by what they're doing on the straightaway. I can tell you that at Eagle, I think the track record overall any class is like 10 seconds. And that was either in a World of Outlaw or a 360 sprint car.
Well, I know at Eagle, and here's another interesting stat. At Eagle, you can pretty much take every class and there's 1 second between
us. Yes.
You know, it just roughly, it's about a second between us. So, you know, the sprints are a second faster a lap than the A-mods. The A-mods, B-mods, you know, that's generally how it works out. And I wouldn't doubt if that gap hasn't even closed up now as technology's gotten better and rules have changed and things like that.
Now, if we can sit there, you know, like I said, if you go back on my Facebook page into 2014, you'll actually see me with the radar gun. And I think I do have some of the pictures posted of the radar gun. So if we're doing 127 mile an hour with some of the Lucas Oil late models at IE, how fast do you think these guys are going on a track, say, like Belleville? Oh, dear Lord. That's insane. Now, one thing I was told was back years ago when Denison was the big, you know, 9/16 mile track, I've been told that there was 150, 160 mile an hour straightaway speeds before he got into the corner, which wouldn't shock me with this big track.
It wouldn't shock me either. And one of the things I've noticed too is, like, you know, you run at Eagle and then you run at I-80. Speed is relative. You don't feel like you're going any faster because everybody around you is going the same speed. You know, but to sum it all up, to be honest, we really don't know how fast we're going.
No, I've often at times wanted to put a speedometer in my car, you know, run a cable back to the Power Glide, maybe take a GoPro and show that. I think that would be awesome footage.
Well, there you have it, Aaron. There's the answer to your question. We don't know. We can only guess.
I'm fast, he's slow.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, I have footage of it.
I have a point sheet on the floor that says you're not.
Yeah. So I tell you what, stay tuned. It's Slingin Dirt TV. We'll be back next week.
Wait. I tell you what. Last week, a few of you emailed us and let us know that I tell you what, Buddy Ray will get your names and he will be sending you your 3 free tickets.
There you go.
Now.
So I tell you what, we'll be back next week here on Slingin Dirt TV, presented by Joe's Garden.